Hi, this video is the sixth and final part in a tutorial series on Chopin's etude, Opus 25, number 6. We look together at bars 35 to the end, that's to say where we left off in the preceding video, part 5, to begin. Let's look back through the piece at the various ways Chopin transforms the basic double third scale into a beautifully musical study. When playing 25-6, we are aware of the forearm movements and how the double thirds feel in their numerous guises under our fingers. I'll attempt to interpret the way the double thirds feel and sound visually in 13 double third elements. Each element has its own dynamic character. Some are comparatively long, some short. They use the full range of the treble and are contrasted side by side but unified together as a whole. We start with shallow zigzags. Short turns in loops. Smooth chromatic scale up, G sharp harmonic minor down, zigzags that climb and fall, shallow zigzags down, smooth, shallow, horizontal waves. Long, deep zigzags down. Deep double zigzags in contrary motion. Short, smooth waves down. B major scale down to G sharp minor. Smooth, undulating horizontal waves. Finishing with a 4-octave chromatic scale down. From bar 35 onwards, we replay the double third elements in much the same way as we have done up to this point. It's worth looking at two important double third scales down. The first is in A major and resolves to G sharp minor. It's the only place the right hand plays a scale as a solo, and it's sometimes treated almost as a cadenza. The first way to play it is with the right hand alone, like this. The second way to play it is to divide the scale between the hands. The double third C sharp and E are sometimes taken with the left hand. It's a way to ensure maximum smoothness of what is in essence a solo at a very rapid tempo. The last double third scale is chromatic and over 4 octaves long. It has several fingerings. I prefer to change the fingering we've used through the video series at this point. Here is my fingering. It enables the fastest of double third scales down with relative ease. Notice there is no repetition of the thumb on the white keys E and F, B and C. Occasionally, in chromatic double third scale practice, we play the top notes with fingers 3, 4 and 5 in legato and the bottom notes in staccato. These bars are very similar to opus 10-2 and it's best to alternate legato and staccato practice in the same way. The more confidently you join the top notes together in legato, the easier they are to play and potentially more expressive too. Left hand is enjoyable to practice alone as it's expressive, and although it doesn't have a melody in the usual sense of the word, it sings in its own unique way. The playing of the left hand is technically straightforward, but the dynamics have subtle colouring. In the double third chromatic scales upwards, for example, the left hand can decrescendo while the right hand crescendos. Contrary dynamics are not so easy, and getting the balance so all the thirds can be heard clearly takes some practice. Thank you. The closing bars can be played by voicing the upper note as a melody. The final chord leaves us on the brighter key of G sharp major. And on that cheerful note, I'll say thanks for watching.